Most people's experience with maths is in school, where a worksheet might ask you to find x, and in response you have to wheel out some memorized formula or procedure. Math research, though, is nothing like that. To be a mathematician, you need to develop both your creativity and your rigor, and there are no set rules to follow. Most of the time, you don't even know where you're going to end up, and it's exciting and terrifying. At least, that was my experience. In math, you first have some theoretical object that you're interested in, and you try and discover facts about this object. In my research, which was a sort of weird mix between theoretical physics and mathematics, the research was about the theoretical object of quantum computers. You might object that quantum computers are real objects now, and that's true, but the quantum computers that I was studying were theoretical abstractions of these things, the platonic ideals that exist in the realm of math and not in the messy real world. Anyway, I was trying to derive facts or theorems about quantum computers. This may not sound so different from science, where you're trying to make observations about an object, but the method is very different. For starters, there's no physical objects. Any statements that you make have to be justified by logic alone. Here's how I think of that process by way of analogy. When a mathematician wants to show others that a theorem is true, it's like they're trying to convince the other mathematician that they've discovered some magical place. They can tell their peers that this place exists, but that alone isn't that convincing. So instead, they have to prove it to them. They start from facts that they both accept are true. Let's say that's this starting point on the map. Then they have to show that the facts that they know imply, without a doubt, another fact. This is a step in the right direction. They keep proving more and more facts that unquestionably follow from what's already known, taking more and more steps, until at last they arrive at the destination. This is your proof. Your fellow mathematicians can walk along the path of well-laid logic to get to the destination themselves now, and so they can verify for themselves that your theorem is true. In this way, math is about extreme rigor. When we prove something's true, we don't mean it's mostly true or it's almost always true. We mean that it's a fact, true and eternal. This, though, doesn't mean that the process of coming up with that fact is anywhere near as certain or solid. There's two giant sources of uncertainty in math research that make it emotionally very tough. When you're trying to prove something's true for the first time, you have no idea whether you're heading in the right direction. You might prove that one fact follows from your assumptions, but is that a useful step on the path, or is it some dead end? You don't know. Sometimes the only path to a destination is to go on what seems like an extreme tangent and then finally circle back. So it's never clear whether you're going the right way, because proofs are far from linear. The second and biggest source of uncertainty, though, is whether the thing that you're trying to prove is true at all. Imagine you spend a long time, let's say months, years, or even decades, trying to prove something, but you just can't get there. Maybe that's because there is no correct path to that magical result after all, because it doesn't exist. The theorem that you're trying to prove isn't true. The only way to verify that it really was a mirage is to prove that the opposite fact is true. Most likely, though, you won't make it to that spot either. You'll just languish in the middle, unsure of what's true. At some point, you just have to let the search go, with nothing to show for all those efforts. How do you protect against these fates? That's where intuition comes in. You need to have a strong gut feeling about what's true, long before you can prove it. The only way that you can justify feelings like this is by noting that it would be ugly if that thing wasn't true. These strong hunches are how you commit to what things you're going to try and prove. But the other thing you need the intuition for is to guess what the overall proof of that fact might look like. For that, you need to have insight into why you think that thing is true, fundamentally. This is why creativity and intuition, bordering on wishful thinking, is as important to a mathematician as rigor. The tension between these two is what makes mathematics such an interesting intellectual endeavor, but it's also what makes it hard. If you're too rigorous and you're not willing to entertain ideas, then you'll prove what you set out for, but what you set out for won't be impressive. But if you're more on the creative side, like me, then your dreams will be bigger than anything you can ever rigorously show is true. Let me tell you about one of those times that happened to me. This is the story of my first PhD research project. When I started my program, my supervisor gave me a few different papers and told me to read them and think about them. So I read this paper and it had an extension to a very important theorem in quantum computing in it. And after I read it, I just had this like gut feeling that this theorem probably could be extended even further in a way that would have like some really cool implications. The only justification that I had for feeling that way was that it, like, the implications were so cool that it just had to be true. And so I started reading this paper very intensely to get clues on how I could extend it further. The proof in this paper, though, was short and dense. The reason is, when a mathematician comes up with a proof, they have all these pictures and stories in their mind about why it works. When they write it down, though, the convention in math is that you remove all of that and give the most linear and concise explanation. That's good for convincing others that you really did prove the thing, because they can easily read line one, check that it does indeed imply line two, etc., all the way to the conclusion. They can know that your proof is solid. But it's very bad for conveying that intuition about why the theorem is true to someone who's reading the paper. That's why I spent months reading this one proof, sometimes spending weeks dissecting a single line. To get the why behind a proof, you somehow need to recreate those stories and pictures in your own head. But the only way you can really do this is by somewhat rediscovering them yourself. So that's what I tried to do. When there was a step in the proof where I could verify what they did was correct, but I had no idea why they thought to do this exact thing, I'd think, how would I have done it? If I wanted to get from A to B, then how would I have gone? This is the part that would take weeks. Often I'd think I'd come up with some totally new way of doing it and be really excited, but inevitably after a while I'd see that this was equivalent to the way that they did it. Which is a good thing, because now the step that seemed like it was a very confusing move for them to make suddenly seems like the most natural direction to go with this proof. After many months of reading and understanding that one paper, I got even more convinced that this extension must be true, so I set about proving it. I walked to and from the department every day, and these walks were the most productive parts of my day because they allowed me to be more creative. Like I've explained before, creativity is super important when you're trying to discover the core reason that something must be true. The reason the walks allowed creativity is because I didn't have a pen and paper with me. I'd have to think about the ideas, not the equations, which allowed me to make much more loose associations and be creative instead of thinking the same thoughts again and again. Another important aspect of creativity is that you have to be able to entertain incorrect ideas. Often when you discover a truth for the first time, you haven't got the details quite right yet, but the core of it is there. That's why it was good for me to not have pen and paper on hand, because when you're writing something, you can check each of the details as you go, and so if you end up going a little bit in the wrong direction, it's very hard to push on in that direction. So it's better not to know that you're wrong straight away. That said, it's not like most of the things that I was thinking on those walks were truths in disguise. What would happen is I'd get to the office every morning and be really excited thinking that I'd discovered something, only to write it down and realize that it was all wrong. Still, I think back fondly to those walks to the department because I think that's where I did the majority of my maths research. There's nothing like the feeling of being obsessed with a mathematical problem and having the pictures invade your mind and pursue you down the street. In fact, I eventually organized my day around those walks. After arriving at the department, I'd go straight to the library, usually without my laptop so I couldn't be disturbed, and then did 3 to 4 hours of work to see if the ideas from the walk amounted to anything. After that, I had lunch with my friends and spent the rest of the day doing admin tasks because I knew I wouldn't really have the mental energy for more actual work. Finally, on the way home, I'd see if there were any more new ideas, and if not, I'd just think about what I was going to eat that night. A year in, things were going great on this project. All the little steps seemed to finally be there in my mind, and so I started writing out everything very precisely. It was only then, after all that time, that I noticed a fatal flaw in my argument. There was a factor of 1 on 2 to the n that I'd never paid much attention to before because I thought it would just go away with this or that trick. But when I wrote it all down, There it stubbornly was, and despite all of my attempts to make it go away, it just wouldn't. And so I had to admit, after many intense months of work, that I was wrong. Being wrong in maths hurts so much because there's often no salvaging that situation. You've written out this path to this amazing mathematical fact, and then you've discovered that one of these steps wasn't rigorous, and so now that path doesn't get you there. You can look at the path that you have left and see if that's worth anything. Is the new spot on your map a place that you could advertise to your fellow mathematicians? Often though, despite this new destination being tantalizingly close, it's not much to look at itself, and so you're not going to be able to sell it. You will no doubt spend time trying to patch up the original path, but to no avail. And ultimately, you need to give up on this project with nothing to show for it. But even though you have nothing to show anyone else, the journey definitely changes you. At least that's what I found. Like I said, I'm much stronger on the creative side than on the rigorous side. But through the ups, downs, and ultimate failure of this project, I learned to be way more careful. So that's something. And I also picked up a bunch of technical skills on the way. Also, when I finally moved on to other projects, I'd fail at those, but I'd fail a lot faster, which I took as a sign of progress. This story, though, ultimately has a happy ending. A few months later, I was reading another paper when I realized that you could interpret their result as something that would get you 90% of the way to the original thing I wanted to prove. I got super excited and spent ages thinking about how to get that last step. In the end though, I didn't need to invent anything myself. There was another result that was seemingly about a fairly different topic that you could interpret in just the right way to make it slot in that gap. I was ecstatic, my first result, and I didn't even have to do any of the work myself. There's a moral in there somewhere. Doing maths is like being on a roller coaster, because finding a true mathematical fact is a heady rush, and then realizing that you made an error is like the floor just fell out from under you. Being wrong and wasting a year and a half of research isn't even the worst time that I was wrong during my PhD. That was definitely the time where I accidentally published something that had a mistake in it and spent 3 months scrambling to fix it. But I'll tell you about that some other time. Anyway, thanks for watching.